to go to the Lord in prayer this morning. The only prayer request I have right off the bat is Sister Jenny Morrell. But let's remember to pray for our pastor as he's away. Just pray that he has a good time, comes back rested, and fresh to the Lord. If you have a need, and if you couldn't just wave your hand before the Lord this morning, let's take this service and these needs before the throne of God. We love you, Jesus. God, we worship your name today, God. Ask you to have your way, Lord, and heal. Hallelujah. If you believe it, you say amen. Amen. You can be seated if you want to. Worship with us.
His holy name. I will sing unto the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. I will sing unto the Lord and bless his holy name. You are holy, you are righteous, you are magnificent, you are victorious, you are mighty, you are omnipotent. There is none that can compare. I come to bless your name. Sing unto, I will sing unto the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. I will sing unto the Lord and bless his holy name. I will sing unto the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. I will sing. I will sing unto the Lord and bless his holy name. Oh, you are holy, you are righteous, you are magnificent, you are victorious. Oh, you are mighty, you are omnipotent. There is none that can compare. You are victorious, you are mighty, you are omnipotent. There is none that can compare. I've come to bless your name.
Oh, hallelujah.
Bless his name, bless his name. Let everybody come in. Bless his name.
Oh, bless his name.
Bless his name. Let everybody come in. Bless his name.
Let's just stay.
are magnificent. You are victorious. You are mighty. You are omnipotent. There is none that can compare. I've come to bless your name.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Can we bless that name right now? Oh, hallelujah. We worship your name, Jesus. There's no name like that name. Hallelujah. We give you praise today, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. We praise you. Extend our hands and sing this to the Lord. Oh, and
everything I need,
Lord,
is you.
God, I've got to have you more than anything.
Everything I need
is you.
Is
It's you, my beginning, my forever. Everything I need is you.
And all the love and Savior prayed. Carabotto sayarabo.
Abba, Father, have your way.
Oh, though they know it,
though they know not what they do,
God, let the cross draw men.
God, let the cross draw men to you. Oh, how many times have I broken your heart?
Oh, but still you forgive. If only
I ask.
I'm not trying to just hype somebody up, but I feel it's the Holy Ghost. We just sang about God's love, and the last verse talks about him dying on the cross. But since he died on the cross and he rose again, we have that same authority and that same power in this house today. And I don't know what somebody's been dealing with. I feel the Lord urging me to tell somebody, if you'll begin to use that same power that lives on the inside of you to speak into your situation, God can begin to move right where you're at. If you came in here and needed an answer, it's in this house today. If you need a healing in your body, if you can begin to lift your hands, and that same power that is inside of you, that same Jesus who's living inside of you, I wonder if we couldn't lift our voice and triumphantly shout unto God and let him know, hey, the enemy's been defeated. Satan, you have no power here. And watch God begin to move in your life.
The enemy has been defeated.
I wish somebody would begin to speak with authority. Hallelujah.
Lift our voice in victory. We're gonna make your praises loud. Shout out to God with the voice of triumph.
I wish somebody would shout on a Sunday morning. We need to shout
to God with the voice of triumph. We need to name him. We need to name him.
anybody triumphing in this house this morning?
Shout out to God with the voice of triumph.
We lift your name up.
We lift your name up. Shout out to God with the voice of triumph.
We shout
out to God with the voice of praise. Shout out to God with the voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up.
Hallelujah. Can we give a triumphant shout unto God, who's never been defeated, who's never lost a battle? Oh, hallelujah. Katosaya. I really feel that. I don't know who this morning came with opposition against him. Before you leave this morning, you can leave with that opposition going the other way. You don't have to leave the same way you came in. If you leave feeling, if you brought this morning feeling heavy, you can leave feeling light in the Holy Ghost. You don't have to bring that same baggage and that same bondage you came in with this morning. The enemy's already been defeated. I wish we believed that this morning. We're a triumphant church. We're serving a God who's never been defeated. Oh, hallelujah. 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 You can be seated if you want to. We ask these morning's ushers to come at this time. Wait on us. You worship with us and give unto the Lord.
From every nation rising to your throne. Saints from every generation singing of your glory, telling what you've done. From the north and south we are crying out, there is hope in the pain.
Hallelujah, Lord, we worship you, God. We worship you, Lord. God, there's none like unto you. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, you can be seated if you want to. Amen. If at this time, if 12 through, I believe it's just graduation of high school, will go down this morning, Sunday school. Transition this service this time. I got to hear his son preach Friday night, and he did an outstanding job. If you were here at Youth Chapel, I'm thankful for what Brother Corbin preached Friday night, and I'm thankful to get to hear his father, Brother Matt Adams, this Sunday morning. I'm very thankful for this man behind me. He's had such a very great impact on my life, and he still does today. I'm thankful for his commitment to the kingdom. I wonder if you couldn't greet Brother Matt Adams this pulpit with an apostolic amen this morning.
Hallelujah. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Got a couple of real quick things before I get started. Announcement-wise, we were going to announce this Wednesday night last week, and pastor was going to announce it at the end of service, and the way God moved in here, we did not announce it. But this coming Wednesday night, there will be no service here at all. And as he's announced already, our next service will be next Sunday night. Pardon me, after tonight, our next service will be next Sunday morning in our new sanctuary. Excited about that, and we're going to meet in here on Sunday morning. Don't forget that. Don't go next door next Sunday morning just yet. We're going to meet inside the sanctuary here, and pastor's got some things he wants to do. And then he said Wednesday night we're going to have a victory march over to next door, and then we're going to have some church. Hallelujah. So Wednesday night, if you want to be in prayer, that would be wonderful for us. We've got a lot of stuff yet to prepare for this upcoming Sunday, and we're trying to get some things worked out and trying to get some things ready, and looking forward to what the Lord is going to do next door next Sunday. And we miss our pastor today. He texted me early this morning, and there's nothing like your pastor texting you and letting him know that he's praying for you. And I appreciate my pastor, love my pastor. Our bishop today is in Knox, Indiana, preaching for them. And as we go today, let's pray for them. God would have his way. If you would stand for the reading of the word, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, starting in verse 1. We've got it on the screen. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you the first of all which I also received, how Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen of Caiaphas, and then of the 12. After that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present. But some are fallen asleep. After that, he was seen of James, then all the apostles, and at last of all, he was seen of me also as one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that I am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and by his grace, which was bestowed on me, was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. I wonder if we couldn't put our Bibles down and lift our hands all across this room and ask God to speak to us this morning. God, I ask God if you would use these lips. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated. Can we have some fun this morning in the Holy Ghost? I am Daniel. I am Sam. Sam I am. That Sam I am, that Sam I am, I do not like that Sam I am. Do you like green eggs and ham? Now see, this is a conversation. It's a poem, but it's a conversation. I do not like them, Sam I am. I do not like green eggs and ham. Would you like them here or there? I would not like them here or there. I would not like them anywhere. I do not like green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam I am. Now, I won't read the whole thing because it is long. But he gets down to the end. And he says, would you, could you, on a boat? To which Daniel replies, I could not, would not, on a boat. I will not with a goat. I will not eat them in the rain. I will not eat them on a train. Not in the dark, not in a tree, not in a car. You let me be. I do not like them in a box. I do not like them with a fox. I will not eat them in a house. I do not like them with a mouse. I do not like them here or there. I do not like them anywhere. I do not like green eggs and ham. I do not like them, Sam I am. Now, I've never opened a message with Dr. Seuss in my life. So bear with me just a moment here. But the Apostle Paul, In our text, said one little scripture, one little part that I'm going to take my title from this morning. And he said, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. You see, there was a man chosen by God simply to serve tables and to work in the kingdom of God. It's even recorded that he was full of faith and power and did great wonders and miracles among the people. He was chosen because he was full of the Holy Ghost. Yet he was still questioned and he was still disputed with by the church people who did not understand the message that this man was preaching. You see, in Acts 6, Stephen had a mandate from the apostles. He had a mandate to serve tables. He had a mandate to feed the people. He had a mandate to take care of the widows, take care of the people that in the church, take care of the people around the church. Reach out, be an arm, be a strength to those around you so that people can, so that the ministry can preach, can focus on souls. And your job is to just reach with your hands. Your job is just to be a servant in any way that you can. But you see, Stephen was excited. He wasn't called to preach a general conference. He wasn't called to get up on the stage of a great meeting. He wasn't called to be the general superintendent of some organization. He wasn't called to be a department leader in the church. He was called to be a door greeter. He was called to clean the restrooms. He was called to sweep the floors. He was called to clean the windows. He was called to help with the widows. And he was so excited to do his job that he just couldn't keep quiet about Jesus. He couldn't keep his mouth closed about the one that had changed his life. He couldn't keep his mouth closed about the one that had delivered him from who knows what. But the Bible says that he was full of the Holy Ghost. See, he was so excited to do his job, and he began to talk in Acts 6 and 7. And the Bible says the word of God was increased, and the number of the disciples were multiplied in Jerusalem greatly. And a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. And Stephen, being full of power, faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. See, I can see him now going from table to table, saying, Brother Clark, you don't understand. I know I'm here to help you, and I know I'm here to serve you today, but you don't understand how God changed my life. You don't understand that Jesus Christ was crucified and that he rose on the third day and he came that I might have newness of life. He came and he put his spirit inside of me and the old man that I was, the old thing that I was has passed away. You don't understand the God that I serve. Just let me tell you about it. Can I sit down for just a moment? Can I sit down and tell you how good the God is that I serve? You see, Stephen, he just couldn't keep quiet. I could see him witnessing, walking around to somebody at their local market or Walmart. Hey, I know I'm just here. I've got to pick up some supplies for the church. But I just saw you standing here, and I want you to know. I want you to know that the God that I serve, he picked me up out of a horrible pit, and he turned my life around. And you know what? He wants to do the same for you. And I could just imagine Stephen, everywhere he went, he began to reach and he began to talk and he began to tell people, you've got to come see, you've got to come to my church. You've got to understand what I'm talking about. You've got to see the miracles that we've seen. I can't just tell you about them. You got to come see them. I can imagine Stephen being so excited that he didn't leave one person around him unwitnessed to. But you see, there was a group of people that didn't like Stephen's enthusiasm because it didn't fit with their religious traditions. It didn't fit with their day because he was talking about Jesus Christ and him crucified. And now he rose on the third day. And the high priest and the Sadducees and those in the Sanhedrin didn't believe that Jesus Christ was the risen king. They didn't want to believe what they had already witnessed and experienced and seen, that he was crucified. That they bury him in a tomb. And that 3 days later, the stone was rolled away. They can't explain the stone. They can't explain why he's not here. But they just don't believe that God really came back and took his son. They don't believe that. They don't believe that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. They don't believe that at all. When they brought him in to question him, the high priest asked him, are these things so? And the Bible says in 6 and 15, as they and all that sat in the council, looking steadfastly on him, saw his face as it was the face of an angel. Have you ever been so mad at somebody? And you know you're right. You know that you're right. You've got all the facts. And you sit them down and start talking to them, and they sit and smile at you. You ever been there? You have teenage kids? You ever been there? They look at you like, I didn't do anything wrong. I don't know what you're talking about. And they smile. They have the face of an angel. Are these things so? Stephen began to give his whole sermon. Bible doesn't say he ever stood on top of idols and preached like Paul. Bible never says that he got up behind a pulpit and he spoke to thousands or even 20, 30 people. He was called in before a council of high priests and religious leaders of that day that were questioning him, why are you talking about something that we don't agree with and we don't believe? That was it. But Stephen began to speak. He took them through the history of the Jewish people in chapter 7. In just a few minutes of time, I'm not going to read them all because there's 53 verses, but in just a few moments of time that it takes to read 53 verses, Stephen began to walk them through the history of how they got where they are, where they came from, and where they are today. He said, men and brethren and fathers, listen up or hearken. The God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he dwelt in Haran and said unto him, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and come into the land which I'll show thee. After the promises of Abraham, Stephen began to go on and began to tell him about the famine of Jacob and about the placement of Joseph in Egypt, just so that the people of Israel could be saved. Then he began to tell him about the captivity that Israel went through and the birth of Moses and the ascension of the palace of Moses that was nothing more than divine ordination by God. He began to walk them through how Moses was schooled and learned the wisdom of the Egyptians, how he defended one of his brethren, and was rejected by those same brethren who he cared for. He began to talk about how Moses ran to the desert and was gone for 40 years. And one day after 40 years, a burning bush came before him that was not being consumed. And a voice spoke out and told him what to do.
He began to go through all of the history of Israel, how the fathers had a tabernacle in the wilderness, as he had appointed, speaking unto Moses, that he should make it according to the fashion of which he had seen, which also our fathers came after and brought with Jesus into the possession of the Gentiles, whom God drave out before the face of our fathers. Until the days of David, who had favor before the Lord and desired to build a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. But Solomon built him a house. Howbeit the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands. As saith the prophet, heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Say, what house will ye build me, saith the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? Hath not my hands made all these things? Stephen was letting him know, you're sitting on religious traditions and you're sitting on your couches inside of the palace, or inside of the tabernacle. You're sitting on inside the place that man made. But I'm telling you something, that God made everything with his hands, and God doesn't desire to live in this house. God desires to live in your tabernacle. Then he finishes by calling their religious traditions to the front. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do ye. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? He got down to where they were living. He began to talk to them about, where have you put your hands on the ministry? Where have you put your hands on the kingdom of God? What have you done for the kingdom of God besides persecute those that have a desire to see the kingdom of God grow? You've slain them which showed before the coming of the just one, of whom ye have now been the betrayers and murderers. He let them know, the just one that I'm talking about, you're the one that's responsible. You're the one that's responsible for sending him to the cross. Who have received by the law the disposition of angels and have not kept it. And this is where it turns. When they heard these things, the Bible says they were cut to the heart. They were cut to the heart. It hurt them so bad inside that they gnashed on him with their teeth. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand, and said, behold, I see the heavens open. And they ran on him with one accord. They stopped their ears. They cried with a loud voice, and they ran on him with one accord, cast him out of the city, and they stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet, whose name was Saul. They stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. So no matter who picked up a stone, no matter who threw a stone, could you imagine being down on your knees in a crowd of people where they're getting ready to stone you, and seeing someone with a big rock begin to throw it, and you know it's going to hurt? Have you ever winced when something's going to hit you, but you just can't get out of the way because there's one coming from the other side? The pain, the agony that he went through, yet he stood steadfast and said, Lord, receive my spirit. I'm not going to get angry at these men. I'm not going to get angry because they don't even know what they're doing. I can imagine he looked over out of the corner of one of his eyes that was all bloody and that was all swollen. And he looked over and he saw a young man standing there all smug, standing there with a coat draped over his arm, standing there with clothes around his feet, just watching the whole thing take place. Because you see, Paul, or Saul, was there that day. So for the next few minutes, if you'll allow me the liberty, I'd like to step into the mind of Saul. They laid their clothes down at my feet. I'm standing here holding a coat, watching this. This is kind of entertaining. Watching someone that I believe is wrong get hurt. I'm standing here watching because I have a letter in my pocket, and I'm going to go continue, and I'm going to make sure that every heretic and every person that doesn't believe the law gets persecuted. Because I believe that they're wrong. I will fight because I believe that they are wrong. Does he think he is telling me, a scholar? I'm standing here. I am a scholar. He's telling me about a man who died for me? No way. Even if he did. Okay, so he died. Yes, he died. Okay. Him living again? If the dead don't walk the street, where are my grandparents? Where are the friends that I have seen die? The dead don't live again. They don't walk the streets. No, it's lies. It's lies. One does not just simply rise from the dead. I don't believe it. What I do know is that I'm unmoved in my pursuit to see these Jesus followers persecuted to the maximum extent of the law. If they won't recant, they will die. This is how strong I believe it. I won't be moved. I won't be changed. Now let's fast forward just a few short years where Saul had a life change and is now Paul. In 1 Corinthians 15, he begins to say, "For I delivered unto you of all which I also have received, that Christ died for us, our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures." He begins to describe all the people that he was seen by. He begins to describe the people that had witnessed this man, Jesus, that had risen from the dead. You see, Paul was talking to those in Corinthians who had unbelief. Because he carries on in a few verses later and says, "Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there be no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen." Christ is not risen. "And if Christ not be risen, then our preaching is in vain. And your faith is also in vain. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom he raised not up." So Paul is challenging these people's faith, letting them know, I've already been through this once before. I've already stood there and I've already questioned a man of God telling me that Jesus Christ had died and had rose again for my sins and that I can have the Holy Ghost. Paul was letting him know that if this didn't happen, then everything I'm saying to you, I am wasting my breath. And everything that you believe in, you're wasting your time. "But now Christ has risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so all shall be made alive. Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall all not sleep, but shall all be changed in a moment. In the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we all shall be changed. For death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But the thanks be to God, which giveth us victory through God, our Lord Jesus Christ." Then Paul ends it by saying, "Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much ye shall know your labor in the Lord is not in vain." You see, Paul found out that labor in the kingdom of God is never in vain. No matter how small, insignificant you may think it is, whether it's serving a table, cleaning a restroom, sweeping a floor, witnessing to someone at every table, speaking out at Walmart, speaking out at the gas station when you see that person come in that is hurting, and your Holy Ghost being full of the Holy Ghost, be able to talk to them. Be able to tell them that there is hope for you in Jesus Christ. You can't work hard enough in the kingdom of God. And there's always a soul to reach. Always a hand to hold. Always his kingdom to build. I began to listen to Corbin preach Sunday or Friday night. And I began to get excited because I knew what God had given me for this morning about passion. God has to become our passion. The passion of God has to become our passion. You see, in Luke 10, the word prayer is all through the Bible. Pray, prayer, pray, prayer. Jesus tells his disciples, they came and said, teach us to pray, Master. And he said, when you pray, pray like this. There's all kinds of places in the Bible where it talks about prayer. But in Luke 10, Jesus had his own request. Could you imagine this morning if the King of Kings would step into the sanctuary while we were taking prayer requests and would just slip his hand up and say, I've got one I'd like you to pray for. I've got one that I'd like you to pray for. The harvest is truly great. But Jesus was telling them, the laborers, people that are willing to work in the kingdom of God, people that are willing to reach for that lost soul, people are willing to do everything they can not to see anyone go to hell around them, they're becoming few. And his prayer request is this. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he would send forth laborers. We can't do this on our own. We can't do this on our own. The passion of God, the souls, have got to become our passion. And you see, that's why Paul could say in 1 Corinthians 5 and 10, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. I'm not what I used to be, but I am what I am today, but by the grace of God. And then he goes on to say, but for, I am what I am by the grace of God, and his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain. I don't want God to ever look down at me and say, I gave you something, I gave you grace, I gave you an opportunity to become something in the kingdom of God, but it was in vain. Paul said, his grace that he bestowed upon me, God, it's not in vain. I'm not going to let it become in vain. So then he turns around and he says, I labored more abundantly than they all. And Paul wasn't making a bragging statement. He was just saying, from the day that God changed me, I made up my mind that there's going to be nobody win more souls than me. There's going to be nobody preach harder than I do. There's going to be nobody reach for that lost one like I can. I labored more abundantly than they all. But he gives acknowledgement to God. Yet not I. It's not me. It's the grace of God that works in me. It's the grace of God that was with me that helps me reach those people. But for the grace of God, there go I. Can I just be transparent for about 30 seconds? I've never in my life been hooked on drugs. I've never been addicted to alcohol. And I thank God for that. And there are some of those in here that have. And I thank God today that you're delivered. But I can't correlate and understand what it's like to wake up on a three-day binge. I don't understand what it's like to wake up hungover, high, sick, and know that I've got to have a fix before something happens. I can't relate to that. But such were some of you. You can relate to that. And there are people out there that you see. You can look at somebody that walks in a store and you know the signs, you know the symptoms. You can look at them and know that they've got a drug problem. They've got an alcohol problem. And who better to reach for somebody than somebody that is full of the Holy Ghost? Somebody that knows what it's like to be delivered. Somebody that knows what it's like. Somebody that knows what it's like to say, I'm laboring more than anybody else because I am what I am by the grace of God. That's why Paul could say, it didn't matter It's the grace of God. Therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preach, and so ye believed. Doesn't matter who's in front of you. It doesn't matter when you're down and out. It doesn't matter whose hand reaches for you. I've never seen a home. We've went downtown, and we've given homeless people food. I've never seen a homeless person say, I don't want a thing from you. I just want to bless you back. They don't care who you are, where you come from. If they've got a need and you've got what they need, they are more than willing to say, okay, I don't even know you. I don't even know if this food is spoiled. I don't know if it's okay. I don't know where you got it out of the dumpster or if you got it from Kroger. But I receive it because I have a need. So Paul was saying, it doesn't matter who you are and it doesn't matter who they are. If they've got a need, whether it's me preaching or whether it's you preaching, whether it's you reaching for them, whether it's me reaching for them, we've got to reach for everyone that we can. We've got to almost shut up. We've got to shut up. We've got to be able to reach. We've got to be able to reach for those that nobody wants. I have to reach this lost world, regardless of what it costs me. See, I could see Paul stepping back in his private times of prayer and reflection. I could see him in his mind's eye going back to the smug young man that stood and watched, looking over at a man that was half beaten, a man that was on his way out of here, a man that was dying, but had enough grace inside not to blame one person around him, but just say, God, receive my spirit. I can see Paul in his private time looking and trying to figure out, what was I doing? What was I doing? Standing there, knowing what I know now, what was I doing standing there? Oh, Stephen, if you could see me now. Stephen, if you could see me now. I took a little bit of artistic liberty. I am Saul. I am Stephen. Stephen, I am. That Stephen, I am. That Stephen, I am. I do not like that Stephen, I am. Do you like the God that I serve? I do not like him, Stephen, I am. I do not like the God that you serve. Would you like him here or there? I do not like him here or there. I would not like him anywhere. I do not like the God that you serve. I do not like him, Stephen, I am. Would you like him in your house? I do not like him in my house. I do not like him here or there. I do not like him anywhere. I do not like the God that you serve. I do not like him, Stephen, I am. I could not, would not on my life. I will not give up my strife. I will not love him in the pain. I will not love him in the rain. Not in the dark, not in me, not in my car. Would you let me be? I do not like him in my life. I do not like this Jesus Christ. I will not let him in my house. I do not like him in my house. I do not like him here or there. I do not like him anywhere. I do not like the God that you serve. I do not like him, Stephen, I am. You do not like him, so you say? Even after all that, even after being beaten, even after being bruised and broken, you do not like him, so you say? Try him. Try him and you may. Try him and you may, I say. Stephen, if you will let me be, I will try him and you will see. Say, I love the God that I serve. I do. I love him, Stephen, I am. I love him in my life. I love him when he took my strife. I will love him in the rain. I will love him in the pain. I love him in the dark. I love him in my car. And I love him in all I am. God is so good you see. I do so love the God that I serve. Thank you, thank you, Stephen, I am. Signed, I am Paul. It doesn't matter how many times you get rejected. It doesn't matter how many times that knock on the door is returned with a closed door. It doesn't matter how many phone calls you make only to hear someone say, I'm not interested in your God. I'm not interested in what you have to say. I do not like him. I don't like him. I don't like him. Whatever they have to say. But see, Stephen never gave up until he was dead. Not one time did he say a railing accusation against anybody who was around him, even though they were the ones personally hurting him. All he did was give it all to God. And he kept testifying about Jesus Christ. He kept testifying about Jesus Christ and him crucified. He kept testifying and reaching and serving tables until the very end. I could hear Paul looking back at Stephen and saying, Stephen, I am what I am by the grace of God. And thank you for being what you were. Because it's of you that I am what I am. Because see, Paul in Romans was able to pen a letter. He was so persuaded that he was willing to kill anybody that did not agree with the law. But in Romans 8, he began to say, what shall we say to these things? For if God be for us, then who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died. Yea, rather, that is risen again. Who is even at the right hand of God who maketh intercession for us? Then Paul begins to look at everybody around him in Romans and tell him, who's going to separate you from the love of God? Are you going to let a bunch of people picking on you separate you from the love of God? Are you going to allow somebody throwing stones your way separate you from the love of God? Shall tribulation, distress, persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, and we are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, all of those things are bad. But in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loves us. For I am persuaded. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creatures shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Stephen, oh Stephen, if you can see me now, if you can see me now, if you can look through time and see me, I am what I am by the grace of God. Stephen, your labor was not in vain. Your labor's not in vain. Therefore, I'm going to work hard to save every soul that I can. Because if it wasn't for you, Stephen, would I be standing here today? Everybody has got a Stephen in their life. Somebody that came to them in a time when they were hurting or hungry or in need. Somebody that came to them and said, let me share with you this Jesus Christ that I love. I wonder how many more Stephens are in this building that are willing to say, I don't care, without fear, without favor. I don't care who they are. I don't care what they look like. I don't care where they're going tomorrow. I'm going to reach for every soul. I am what I am because of the grace of God. Therefore, I'm going to labor more than anybody else. It's not I, but it's the grace of God. I am what I am, Stephen, because of your love for me. I held the coats of the men that killed you, but not one time did you accuse me. I am what I am because of your willingness to share the gospel in spite of what I tried to do to you. If Sister Jenny will come. Can we just lift our hands all across this room? Love the Lord. As I stood in this sanctuary on Friday night, I began to hear Corbin preach. And like I said earlier, my heart began to swell because I began to hear him and watch him preach about the passion of God and the souls. And Charles Spurgeon saying, if they go to hell, let them go to hell over my dead body. Let them go to hell with me clutching onto them. A man that never, to my knowledge, ever had the fullness of God like we have it in this place this morning, was so eager to reach for the souls of men. A couple Sunday nights ago, Brother Morgan Coffey sparked something in my spirit. He began to, as he was finishing up his message, he said, I just feel this in the Lord. Somebody needs to go out and buy a new shirt and tie for that son. It's going to be coming back to church. They're going to need that. And as I was praying last night and again this morning, it's all I could see is a wardrobe full of clothes. Because it's not going to be just a son or a daughter. I begin to see a closet of clothes. New clothes, the best clothes. Because you see, when the prodigal returned, he didn't say, hey, go get something out of the back room and dust it off a little bit and bring it out here. If you have, don't even worry about ironing it. It's just for him. He said, go get the best robe. And I began to see the closet. As people became in one by one, getting clothes out for their loved ones because they're coming home. Not just because they're coming home, because the Bible says you can't come unto God unless he's drawing you. But how he's going to draw them home is a group of people that have a mentality in their mind, that have a heartbeat of God that says, I'll be like Stephen. I don't care who throws stones at me. I don't care who doesn't like my message. I don't care what they say about me. I don't care what I look like. I don't care that they're beating me down. I don't care that they don't want to listen. I'm going to tell them about Jesus. I'm going to tell them, not in a mean way. I'd never call them anything. I let them stone me to death. But I let them know that Jesus Christ died for their sins. I let them know that there's hope beyond what we have right here. I let them know that the there's a place for them in the kingdom of God. No matter what they look like, no matter their past, there's a place for them in the kingdom of God. So if you will stand all across this room this morning. Is there anybody in here this morning that says, I want to be like Stephen because I am what I am because of the grace of God. I didn't get here on my own. I can't do this on my own, but I am what I am by the grace of God. And I'm going to reach. I'm going to prepare. I'm going to prepare the garments like they're coming home today. I'm going to reach for the stalls like they're coming home today. I am what I am. I am what I am by the grace of God. And I don't want to see another lost soul go through my fingers. I don't want to see another lost soul. God, give me the passion. God, give me the passion that no matter what comes my way, I'm still willing to reach. God, until the day that you come back and we're changed, incorruptible. God, give me the passion to reach every soul around me. I am what I am. I am what I am. Thank you, God, that I am what I am by your grace.
I give myself away so you can use me. I give myself away.
I know those are here around the altar that have came up. But you know, when the prodigal came home, it wasn't just the prodigal and his brother and the dad. But the Bible talks about they're going to prepare a feast. Go get the calf. Because this is more than just a one or two person thing. This is more than just, I'm here by myself and I'm going to reach every soul by myself. This is a team effort. This is a group thing. So I wonder, as a family this morning, I wonder if we couldn't gather in behind those that have a need and say, you know what, I'm going to celebrate with you just a little bit early. I'm going to celebrate with you that son coming home, that daughter coming home, that life being restored, that drug addict being delivered, that alcoholic being set free. I'm going to celebrate with you this morning.
Give myself away. myself away so you can use me. And give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. Give myself away. Give myself away so you can use me. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you. My life is not my own. To you I belong. I give myself to you.
Can we sing that as one body?
Life is not my own. To you I belong.
Oh, I give myself.
I give myself to you.
One more time, can we sing my life?
My life is not my own. To you I belong.
I give myself.
I give myself to you.
How long we couldn't see. Lift our hands in this house right now and just thank Him for what we've just heard. This is definitely a message that doesn't stop here. We need to take this home and put it into application every single day on the job, every single day at school, no matter where you're at. God, birth a passion inside of me to reach this world. Thank you, Brother Adams. I said the same thing Friday night, and I hope the solemnness of a message like this doesn't wear off easy. This is a message we've got to take with us. There's so many people that are looking for an answer that only you have inside. Only you've got the key to find them true joy. You can go back to your seats. Amen. You know, I just don't want this message to lose its calling that goes deeper. We've got to reach this world. Hallelujah. Don't forget, church will be here tonight, 6 p.m., 5:30 will be prayer. After service, real quick, I know I'll be cognizant of the time. I realize I talk to most of the young people, but if you're in Chosen or if you're in the youth, I need to meet with you just real quick downstairs. We're getting closer to a deadline for NAYC, so I'm trying to get everything done there I can. If I can meet, if you're in youth group or Chosen, the singles group, I need to meet with you real quick after service downstairs. I'll keep it quick as I can. Other than that, if we can stand, we'll go. We're going to march and give into our tithe and our building fund, our offering. And if you're busy, you have to do this, but we'll go. I never do this right, so I'll just say a direction, and you guys can do it. We'll do east side, west side, and center section, because I never do that right. So if you'll bless the Lord in giving as we go. Amen. Come back tonight ready for a move of the Holy Ghost.